For the past year, we've looked at Apple's base 13-inch MacBook Pro as a pretty bad value compared to Apple's newly updated MacBook Air and the more expensive $1,800 Touch Bar Pro, since it packed a pretty slow dual-core processor and was lacking a few features. But with Apple's new $1,300 base MacBook Pro, we've completely changed our mind, and we're now calling it the best value MacBook ever. Let's discuss everything that's great and not so great about the new base model MacBook Pro. For starters, Apple was able to equip it with a Touch Bar at the same base price, something you previously had to pay $1,800 to get. Now, of course, not everybody likes it, but what really matters is the hardware that comes with it, like Touch ID authentication, which makes it really convenient to log in and install new apps without having to re-enter your password. But the major deal is Apple's T2 chip, which takes care of a bunch of system controllers and makes it much more secure. And on top of that, it brings hardware HEVC video transcoding, and many people believe that HEVC is going to be the future mainstream codec, so having the T2 chip makes this MacBook Pro much more future-proof. Design-wise, almost everything else about the new base MacBook Pro basically matches the more expensive MacBook Pros, like the very color-accurate and bright display with True Tone technology, the class-leading Force Touch trackpad, and the all-aluminum, lightweight, and incredibly thin design. Along with that, we also have the latest version of Apple's Butterfly keyboard, similar to the third gen in 2018, but with updated materials. This alone was a big reason why some people would spend more for the 2018 $1,800 model or go with a MacBook Air instead. The previous base MacBook Pro had a keyboard design from 2016, which was the most prone to failure. Now, we're not sure if the latest design will fix all of the problems just yet, but if any issues arise, Apple will fix them for free. What really makes this year's base MacBook Pro stand out is the new quad-core processor. And from the first glance on Apple's website, it seems like it's quite a bit slower than the $1,800 MacBook Pro's 2.4GHz processor, but that couldn't be further from the truth. We made a full video comparing both models, and we found that under load, the base MacBook Pro ran only 300MHz slower than the $1,800 model, nowhere near the 1GHz or 1,000MHz difference we saw on the spec sheet. We ran a ton of benchmarks, video editing tests, and even some photo editing, and found that the $1,800 MacBook Pro is only around 5-9% faster than the $1,300 model. So for performance alone, it definitely wasn't worth the upgrade. If you're looking to do video editing on a budget, we're able to play back full resolution 4K H.264 and H.265 files without any dropped frames in both Premiere Pro and Final Cut Pro. And even adding color correction in a LUT would be perfectly fine using Final Cut, while Premiere would require you to drop down to half resolution, which is still very usable. But that's not the case for editing in DaVinci Resolve, which likes to have more video memory like on the 15-inch with dedicated graphics. Overall, we're impressed with how this MacBook Pro performs, but keep in mind that final exports will require some patience compared to the 15-inch MacBook Pros, about 2-3 times longer than your project length in Final Cut Pro, or up to 10 times longer in Premiere. So personally, we'd stick with Final Cut. For most people that do simple 4K editing from time to time, this new MacBook Pro will do a surprisingly good job, absolutely smoking the previous model thanks to the quad-core CPU and updated graphics. The same thing goes for photo editing, but here the performance difference between the 13-inch and 15-inch models are even lower, since graphics are hardly used. Importing 50 42-megapixel raw images into Lightroom Classic was very quick, and exporting edited JPEGs was also really impressive. We did notice a small delay in some tasks that we don't get on our 13-inch MacBook Pro with 16 gigs of RAM, which makes sense since the 8GB of RAM are maxed out while editing photos. Upgrading to 16GB of RAM will not only smooth out your editing experience, but speed up exporting as well. If you're doing 12-24MP images in small batches, 8GB will perform well enough. But if you're working with higher resolution files or doing things like HDR, panoramas, or working with hundreds of images, we would highly recommend spending $200 more and upgrading to 16GB of RAM. We also decided to include some programming tests. But unfortunately, us being video editors with absolutely no Xcode experience at all, we weren't able to find and run a sample Xcode project that would be easy to replicate on future machines. So if you guys know of a sample Xcode project we could use, comment below. But from what we've seen so far with this machine, you're getting truly impressive processor performance for the cash out of this 1.4GHz CPU. And we think it's going to perform much better than its Windows rivals and completely blow the 2019 MacBook Air out of the water. We'll be getting our hands on that soon and doing a full comparison, so make sure to subscribe so you see that. And now let's talk about the downsides. When we first got this laptop, we decided to take off the bottom cover and compare the internals to the $1,800 MacBook Pro, and we found a few interesting details. First off, we're only getting a single fan in the base model compared to two on the more expensive Pro. But seeing as we got such impressive performance results with CPU temps that were only slightly hotter than the $1,800 model, that doesn't seem to be a problem. We also noticed that the speakers look way different, and when we tested them, we noticed a huge improvement on the more expensive 13-inch Pro. Just listen for yourself. And then we tested the SSD storage speed, and found that the 128GB SSD was quite a bit slower than the 256GB on the $1,800 model. And not only that, but if you pay the extra $200 to get the 256GB SSD, it's actually still slower than the 256GB on the $1,800 Pro. So there are a couple of downsides already. But the biggest difference is that the $1,300 model only gets two Thunderbolt 3 ports, while the more expensive one gets four of them. So we can see that while the new base MacBook Pro offers incredible value for performance, there are a few things that you have to sacrifice. But let's take a look at all of these things from my own personal opinion and past experiences. As far as performance goes, I think this machine is the way to go if you don't do professional work every day, or if you're doing entry-level basic stuff, like editing YouTube videos. Or if you're doing your work every single day, or if your business depends on it, like editing wedding videos, then I would honestly recommend just jumping to the 15-inch model with dedicated graphics. Or if you're doing a lot of photo editing or programming, I think just getting 16 gigs of RAM on this model would be a great choice for almost everyone. And for the single fan, we didn't really notice higher temps at all. One difference we noticed between this and the dual fan model was that the single fan would keep blowing at max fan speed during longer tasks like exporting, while the dual fan would eventually slow down a bit after temps came down. But as far as performance itself, the single fan is completely fine. Now for the speakers, I personally like to watch YouTube videos, shows, and movies on my MacBook, so that's actually the most important thing for myself, personally. Now if you prefer to use headphones and you like to watch YouTube videos on your phone and shows on your TV, then the speaker difference won't really matter that much to you. And in reality, the $1,300 model's speakers are still better than practically any Windows laptop out there. As for the SSD speed difference, even the slower speeds of the 128GB model are nearly as fast as a lot of the premium laptops out there, like Dell's XPS, so it'll be fine for most people. So you should really just worry about the storage amount itself, unless you know you need faster speeds. And finally, I think the factory 8GB of RAM would be okay for a lot of people, but I personally love to keep a lot of Chrome tabs open, so if you're like me, you'll be much better off with 16 gigs of RAM, and especially if you're doing productivity tasks more than once or twice a week. For the ports, I've found that I don't really use them that often, but even then, it's really convenient to be able to swap the charger to the other side, so it's a lot more convenient. And I also like to charge my phone using a USB-C to Lightning cable, so that's already maxing out two ports. So if I needed to plug something in and transfer some files, I'd need to unplug one of them on the $1,300 model. So if you're planning on actively using the Thunderbolt 3 ports, like for connecting an external display, or working off of an external drive, you probably would be better off going for the $1,800 model with four ports. Now you could make it work with a Thunderbolt 3 hub off Amazon, but it's not as convenient to carry that around. But if you're a simple person who only needs those ports for charging and occasionally connecting an external drive for some quick file transfers, then you should honestly just be fine with those two ports. One last question we want to address that some of you may be asking is if it's worth buying a discounted 2018 four-port model instead of a lower-end 2019 model. Now, the 2018 versions perform almost as good as the 2019s in terms of CPU, but they do have keyboards that have an older design. Personally, if you were going to buy a $1,500 256GB 2019 MacBook Pro and can score an older 4 Thunderbolt model for up to $100 more, we would make that jump since you also get better speakers and faster SSDs, but only if you can get 16 gigs of RAM on that 2018 model. All in all, if you want to get access to macOS and not have to worry about performance issues in the future, I think the 2019 base MacBook Pro for $1,300 is the best value MacBook in years, and I think almost everyone will be happy with it. If you enjoyed this review, make sure to tap that like button and click the circle above to subscribe so you don't miss out on more videos like this one. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video. We'll be right back.